Tonight our text is going to be out of two different places. Genesis chapter 3, we're going to read 8 verses. And then we're going to go over to Ephesians chapter 6 and read about 8 more. Genesis chapter 3, verses 1 through 8. It's been a pleasure to be here. And I'm thankful for those that come up and sing tonight and the good spirit that we had in that. Appreciate you being here tonight. Genesis chapter 3, starting with verse 1. Here the Bible says, "Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said unto the woman, Yea, hath God said, You shall not eat of every tree of the garden? And the woman said unto the serpent, We may eat of the fruit of the trees of the garden, but of the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, You shall not eat of it, neither shall ye touch it, lest you die. And the serpent said unto the woman, You shall not surely die. For God doth know it, that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes shall be opened, and you shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired," underline those words, "a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof, and did eat, and gave also unto her husband with her, and he did eat. And the eyes of them both were opened, and they knew that they were naked. And they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves aprons. And they heard the voice of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day. And Adam and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God amongst the trees of the garden." Now let's turn over to Ephesians chapter 6, verses 10 through 18. Ephesians 6, 10 through 18. And here the Apostle Paul, pen in hand, inspired by God, writing to the church of Ephesus, he says, "Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Wherefore, take unto you the whole armor of God, that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand, stand therefore, having your loins girt about with truth, and having on the breastplate of righteousness, and your feet shod with the preparation of the gospel of peace. Above all, taking the shield of faith, wherewith you shall be able to quench all the fiery darts of the wicked, and take the helmet of salvation and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. Praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints." I'd like to preach just briefly tonight on the subject of Satan's biggest lies. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you so much for this opportunity to be here again tonight. God, for these folks who've come out to worship. God, now we're praying for your help in this message. Lord, open our minds and hearts to receive it. Lord, do a mighty work with your word. God, just keep me out of the flesh tonight, Lord, and only in your word, so that we can have time to tell us. God, we thank you and love you. Please let us feel your spirit tonight. It's these things we ask in the name of Jesus. Amen. Well, we saw there in that very familiar passage of Scripture in Genesis where we saw the end of man. Man was designed to live forever. He wasn't supposed to die. Man was supposed to live. He could have lived eternally and been immortal. But here we see the fall of man when sin entered in. And that sin entered in through, of all things, one of the beasts that God created in the form of Satan. And I want to talk tonight on just a couple of things. There was about 5 things I want to talk about. We're not going to have time, so we'll probably have to limit it down to a couple. But in 1944, and we saw this little documentary not long ago, 1944, that was during the World War II. And Germany, of course, was the ones that was the instigators in that. And over on Omaha Beach in Normandy, the United States and their allies, they landed on that beach, and they finally made it up through there. Lost a lot of men. A lot of good men died trying to take over that island, that beach there. And they finally made it on the land. And once they got on there, they were then faced with these German Nazis that were, they would fight any way possible. They never knew what was going to be coming at them. But the Allies had one weapon that the Nazis didn't really know about. Now, they had this same weapon, but they didn't understand that the Allies had this weapon. And what had happened, they equipped 800 tanks with a flamethrower. And so there was a tank they called the Churchill Mark VII Crocodile. These tanks had been converted into flamethrowers. And they would carry around this tank behind them that would keep it fueled. And it was fueled with nitrogen. And And so they would come in those tanks, and the first thing they would do, they would come and mow everything down with gunfire, with machine guns, and level out the field, as many people as it was in the way, and then they would shoot those flames across there. These flames could shoot 120 yards. That's more than the length of a football field. And they could do it 80 times with 1 second spurts each pull of that trigger. They would throw out these flames across those fields. And it would annihilate everything in its path. It would burn up trees, it burn up bushes, men, anything that got in its way, it would burn up. And they was just running for their life. Friends, it was literally hell upon earth when those things come up on that island. And what I'm trying to get at, when you're faced in the middle of a battle, when it's war, and you know what war is, of course, everything's fair when it comes to war. Well, the devil has that same mentality. You see, the devil wars against us every day. Every day of your life, he will war against you. Friends, we are in a battle. The devil, he don't play fair. All is fair in war, especially when it comes to Satan. Satan is a liar and the father of it. Says so in my Bible in John 8:44. Jesus says, when he's talking to the Pharisees, he says, you are of the father of the devil, your father of the devil, and the lust of your father you will do. He was a murderer from the beginning, and abode not in the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he speaketh a lie, he speaketh of his own, for he is a liar and the father of it. Now, friend, I want you to know that being equipped with that information right there from the Lord, that gives us a little bit of heads up in this battle that we face every day. At least we understand who the enemy is. We understand that he does not play fairly. He does not play by any rules. He's not concerned with your welfare at all. And he's here to take us down. Now that sounds pretty strong, but friends, the devil is out there like a roaring lion seeing who he can devour. The Bible says so. I want us to look at just a couple of these lies that Satan does. Now, right up here in our opening text, we saw in Genesis there that Eve was taken by subtlety, by this serpent. It says the serpent came there into that garden and started enticing her. You know, so the Lord says it to, what, you can't eat of that tree over there. You know, he puts this out in front of her. And one thing I find interesting in that, I really hadn't paid much attention to it until I was studying for this message. And what it says right there in verse 6, it says, and she looked around there and pleasant. It was pleasant to the eyes and a tree to be desired to make one wise. You see, where her sin began after she was tempted by Satan there, it was through her desire. It wasn't through her needs. You know, we think that we need so many things, but a lot of times our needs are really just our desires. Things that we want for ourselves. Our flesh wants things. Well, Eve looks around and she sees this tree and she understands now that she's going to be smart. She's going to be a god. Satan says she's going to be a god. And she falls for it, hook, line, and apple, or fruit, or whatever they had there. It wasn't an apple. It was some kind of fruit. And she fell for it. And she desired it. She wanted to be wise. She wanted to be equal with God. That was the whole thing there. If they become gods and became wise and knew good from bad, then they would be equal with him. Well, Satan tells her that, you know, that's the only reason that God's withholding this information from you is because he knows it'll make you wise and it'll make you a god. And therefore, he's withholding information from you. Well, one of the lies that Satan wants to tell us all is that God is withholding things from us. Now, we get down in our little pity parties a lot of times. We look at these things that we think we want or we need, and we sit around and think and desire and want all these different things, and we can't have them. Now, that man we just spoke to out there, he was talking about how he needed this and needed that and needed that, and all this, didn't have air in his car. I said, brother, I don't have air in my car either. And so I know what you're talking about. But there's things that we think that we need that we really don't need. We just desire those things. And we think, well, if we're a child of God, if God loves us and he can do anything, then how come he's not doing this for us? He must be withholding something from me. I see these other people getting blessed. We talked about this in that last message, I think, Wednesday, or maybe it's last Sunday night, about how people get wrapped up into that, thinking that all these people are getting blessed, all these bad people, people that don't follow God, how they see them getting blessed. And we might get into that frame of mind, friends. We'll start thinking, well, God must not care for me. God must be withholding something from me. And we'll get all upset about it, get down and start complaining. Well, I see from Scripture that that is completely contrary to what the Scripture teaches, that we are supposed to have everything and that we're not going to have any problems. You know, right here in Genesis 3:1, when it says that the serpent was more subtle, this, of course, being subtle, was just being slick. He was being a trickster. That's kind of what the meaning is behind that word. He was being subtle. And we see that he's full E. First of all, we know that right here it says that not only did he trick her, but he called God, of all people, a liar. He said right there that God's lying. I mean, you shall surely not die. But the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat it, neither shall you touch it, lest you die. And the servant said to the woman, you shall not surely die. For God knows that in the day you eat thereof, then your eyes will be opened. He's calling God Almighty, the Creator, a liar. Now we know from Scripture that God cannot lie. He cannot lie. It says in Titus 1:1-2, Paul, a servant of God, an apostle of Jesus Christ, according to the faith of God's elect, and the acknowledging of the truth, which is after godliness. Verse 2 says, in the hope of eternal life, which God, that cannot lie, promised before the world began. Satan starts off telling us that God is a liar. The Father of all lies is telling us that God the Creator, our Father in heaven, is a liar. Friends, we should be able to spot that right off. But sadly, Eve didn't spot that right off. And because of that, then she passed it on down to her husband. And then from her husband, it passed it on down to us. And so, Satan was able to tempt them. And they sinned. That changed history forever. Now, Eve thought that she needed to be like God. She thought she needed to be that way. She didn't need to be that way. She thought God was holding something back from her. She wanted immediate satisfaction. You see, when she found out about that tree and saw that it would make her wise, she thought she needed that right then. I need that right now. Why didn't she go back and think about it a little while? Because the temptation was so strong. It's right there in front. And that's the way Satan will do you. Satan will toss that out there right in front of you, something that's going to get your attention, something that he knows that he can tempt you with. He'll put it right in your face because he knows it's right there in your grasp. Friends, if you've got a problem drinking, he will hold that bottle right in your face. He'll send some. There'll be somebody that will come down through there and stand right in front of you and offer you something to drink. If it's some kind of drug, there'll be somebody come to your house. There'll be somebody call you on the phone. Want to have some kind of party, and they're going to have drugs. Satan will use those opportunities to tempt you and to test you. That's what he did here with Eve. He knew that if he presented this to her, she would desire that. Right there at it. It's right there. It's right there. Reach out and get it. It's for you. It'll make you wise. It'll make you a God. It was just too strong for her not to take it. Now we think we need that. Hey, I really need a brand new Nissan GTR. They're only $60,000. And I'm sure that God wants me to have this car. Friends, I'd love to have one of those cars just to ride around in. I don't need that car. Hey, my little Versa over there with no air in it is a good car. It's good gas mileage. I get real good. I get 400 miles out of a tank of gas. I don't need a GTR. I don't need some kind of big fancy car. I might want it, but it don't need it. You see, we think we need these things. We see somebody else and we say, "Why? If I had that, I'd be happy. It would just make me the happiest man in the world. I need that. You know, I need a nice house. I need the 3-story. I saw somebody build this big 3-story house. Oh, how wonderful it'd be to have so much room. Oh, I need that. We don't need that. I need to be completely happy and satisfied within my job. That's where it hits home with me. I go into a job 5 days a week that I completely detest. I cannot stand it. I would just as soon be sick and laying in bed than go into that place of work. But God blessed me enough to give me a job. And I may not like it, but it doesn't mean that I've got to be comfortable and happy every time I go in the door. God didn't promise me a rose garden. You know, I'm not going to stand up here and try to bamboozle you like some of those slipsters do when they tell you that if you just trust God, He'll provide all your wants and your desires. You'll get all these things that you want, just like my car sitting out there. I'm not going to tell you that tonight because that's not true. That's not what the Bible teaches. You see, the devil will tempt you with these things, thinking that you think that you need them, but you don't need them. They're not needs. They're not needs. They're desires. If you woke up this morning, and I'm pretty sure that everybody in here did, because you're here. And if you woke up and you were breathing again, I think everybody in here woke up breathing because you're here. And if you had something to eat, something on your plate today, so that your stomach's not growling and you're not starved to death, and you've got clothes on your back, which everybody here does, then that is all that we needed today. But yet we wasn't happy, were we? We wanted something else. Friends, we were lucky to have what God provided for us right there. He met our needs with those basic elements. He gave us life, He gave us breath, and He gave us food and clothing. Those are the basic needs of a man or a woman. Those are our needs, and He provided for them. God blesses us. Even that man that was out of the apartment, I don't know his whole story, but God gave him, he's got a car to drive in. He had clothes on, they wasn't real nice. He had some things. He obviously had been eating, he wasn't skin and bones. But God had somehow smiled upon him enough to sustain his life. And he told me out there he would just as soon be dead as to be in life alone. And I said, friend, you've got God. Rely upon God. Pray to Him. Yeah, but I'd rather be dead than be alone, he said. Friends, those kind of things like that, that's what Satan wants us to have, that kind of mindset. How do we battle the devil when he hits us with these lies? Well, over in Luke 4, we see that Jesus was taken out into the desert. And he was tempted out there. He was fasting. He was hungry. He was tired. He was thirsty. And all these things. And Satan came to him to tempt him. And he said, you know, I'll give you all this land as far as you can see. I'll give this to you. I'll give you, turn these stones into bread and eat. You can do it all. You're the Son of God. You can do that, can't you? I'll give you all these things. What did Jesus say? He said, get thee behind me, Satan. Friends, we need, when things are hitting us like that, we need to look and say, Satan, get behind me. I've got God on my side. God is providing and taking care of me. I don't need all that other junk. We read in Ephesians that gird your loins about with the truth. We got to be careful. Get behind Satan. Second point, I'll be done. Another lie that Satan wants to tell us is, as a Christian, we should not have to suffer. Now that one right there gets a lot of people. This lie is especially prepared for Christians. Because he knows that the Christian tries to walk the best life we can. We try to live by God's rules and God's plans and do the things He would have us do. And we want to be joyful people. The Bible says that we should be joyful people. We want to be that way. So Satan will use this lie against us, thinking that we shouldn't have to suffer. If He's the God He says He is, then why are you suffering? You know, He could take care of you. Why is He not doing that? If He's really the God He says He is, why is He allowing you to suffer? I'll never forget, back in 2003, might have been 2 or 3, me and Mary went down to Chattanooga. We went on a Christian tour to see the cathedrals and some of their last concerts. They were going to retire soon. We went down to the Soldiers and whatever it is, stadium down there. Big cathedrals concert. We was like second or third row, right close, man. We could almost reach out and touch Roger Bennett. Roger Bennett was a piano player for the cathedrals. Wonderful, very talented man, gifted by God. Could play the piano, I mean, just like something you never heard in your life. Well, Roger Bennett in 1995 was stricken with leukemia. And he actually had 3 bone marrow transplants. And he went through many radiation, chemotherapy, all these different things. But I'll never forget what he said while he was standing there on that stage. He was standing up there, and he was recounting his life and how things had happened to him. And how that just blowed him out of the water when he got leukemia. He couldn't understand it. He got some lumps burst in his throat. And he couldn't understand it. He was sad about it. He said, but then the worst thing that he ever dreamed of happened. There was a woman come to him that was supposed to be a Christian woman. And she said, Roger, you know why you're going through these problems? You know why you're suffering? Because you're not walking close enough to God. Because your faith is not strong enough. And he said that absolutely floored him. Tore him up, buddy, from one side down the other. Just destroyed his thoughts and everything. And he was sick over it. Why in the world, he said, did she come to him and tell him something like that? He was trying to live a life for God. He always had. He lived the best life he could. But this well-meaning Christian lady, you've not got enough faith. That's why this happened to you. I'll never forget that. And then all of a sudden, he said, but you know what? He said, I look back upon my life. And he said, and when I got cancer, he said, it did blow me apart. He said, I didn't understand it, and I questioned God, and I was angry at times. He said, then I started looking back through the years. Now, this was in 2002 or 3. He'd already had leukemia several years and had been in and out of remission. He was out at the time he was telling us. And he said, I look back, and he said, I want to tell you something. He said, I know there's people right now sitting in this congregation. He said, I know there's some of you right here that have cancer right now. Some of you are taking treatments. Some of you came here tonight because you knew I had leukemia and you wanted to hear my story. He said, I know that some of you didn't hear that. And he said, I'm going to tell you something that you're not going to understand right now probably. He said, but if somebody come and ask me, would you trade what you have with Jesus? Would you trade that life with Jesus if we could declare you cancer free? He said, no, I would not. He said, I would take the cancer over losing my walk with Jesus. He said, as bad as it is, as many trials as he's went through, he's looked back on those years that he's went through treatments and all the things, and he said he has grown 100 times more of a Christian and closer to God than he was before he ever had it. You see, a lot of times our suffering is for our own good. And it's hard to understand. I know it is. I know it's hard. As a Christian, we shouldn't ever think that we're immune from anything like that. And then the most beautiful thing is he stood there beside his friend there, the bass singer, and they're standing there together, and he says, go ahead, George, let's sing the song that we wrote. And he stands up, and they sing this song. The night was so dark, I felt in my heart, my song had come to an end. My spirit was willing, but my body was weak. I thought that this is the way it would end. But Jesus came in like a thief in the night, touched me and I was made whole. My song did not end. I started over again, and I wanted everybody to know the story about my healing. Oh, healing, the great physician ministered healing to my soul. The ills of my body were healed by the stripes of his back. The great physician ministered healing to my soul. As him and George Hunt stood there, both of them now gone. Both of them with cancer. Both of them passed away. Roger Bennett passed away 4 years after that concert where he sung that song and talked about being healed. He passed away. But you know what? He passed away with a testimony. A testimony for God, none other. If that had never happened to him, he wouldn't have had that testimony. You can't even understand the scores of people that he helped with his testimony and with his songs that God had gave him through these trials and how the trials of Christians have helped us so much. You know, we don't understand. We don't want to get in that way. None of us want to have that. As I've watched my sister cling on to life for so long and then at 38 years pass away, at 38 years old, it shouldn't have happened. It should never have happened. But oh, but God had a bigger plan. He had a bigger plan. Many of you have lost people in your lives. And it's hard. I know it is. But friends, a lot of times we can use these things that God allows to happen to us for the good. We can use it for the good. The devil wants us to think that when things are going wrong, life isn't what we expect it to be, that God's abandoned us. That he doesn't care. That is contrary to what Scripture says. I got a few passages of Scripture, and I'm going to close. James, chapter 1, verses 2 and 3. And here he says, my brethren, count it all joy when you fall into diverse temptations, knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience. Did you understand that? He said, when. When. He didn't say if. It is going to happen. There's no question about it. When you fall into diverse temptations. These diverse temptations just mean various trials. Those words, the way they're used there. Various trials. We will have trials in our life. It is going to happen. When it happens, it says count it all joy. Why? How can we do that? How in the world can we be joyful in times like that? Why? Because it says right there, the trying of our faith worketh patience. You know, I've always wanted patience. Friend, be careful when you pray for patience, because the only way you can get it is to go through a trial. That's the only way you can get it. I'm reminded of the Apostle Paul. You remember when he was saved on that road to Damascus? And they were leading him back there, completely blind. He'd been struck down. They're leading him over there to Damascus. And the Lord comes to Ananias in a vision. He says, Ananias, my servant, Saul's coming. I want you to allow him into your house. I want you to lay your hands on him. And he's going to receive his sight. And I want you to do that for me. And then I said, the Lord, he come to persecute. He come here to kill people like me. He come here to arrest people like me. He's got papers. of what the Lord say? He said, no. He said, go thy way, for he's a chosen vessel unto me, to bear my name before the Gentiles and kings and the children of Israel. For I will show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. God's going to use this man and use him greatly. He's one of the greatest writers in the entire Bible, greatest witnesses, missionary, apostle ever to live. God allowed him to suffer. He said, I'll show him how great things he must suffer for my name's sake. I remember Paul had a thorn in the flesh. He prayed 3 times for God to take that from him. God said, finally, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. From that moment on, he quit asking. Although we continue on, we don't understand. Friends, as a Christian, we must finally come to that point in our life where we understand these times that we suffer. I don't care what, I don't care if it's sickness, I don't care if it's financial, I don't care if it's a family issue, I don't care if it's some kind of mental issue. All these things that happen to us, and it happens to all of us, none of us are immune. These things, we can be joyful in knowing that we have Jesus Christ as our Savior. And we can stand there in the face of adversity. And we can say, get behind me, Satan. You're not going to trip me up and make me doubt. You're not going to make me think that God doesn't love me. Get behind me. And we can gird up our loins with the truth. We can put on that helmet of salvation. And we can stand boldly in the name of the Lord. And know that through Him, we can have joy. We may not always be happy and carefree and healthy, but we can have joy through Him. Satan will try to hit us with these lies, but we need to remember, just like the words that God spoke to Apostle Paul, he said, Saul, Paul, my grace is sufficient for you. Can we do that when we face with those trials and temptations, those divers temptations? Can we do it? I believe we can. Charlotte, if you'll come and play the piano, we'll close. As she comes up, let's please stand. I'd like for us to pray together. And I don't know your heart tonight or what you're going through or what you've been through. It doesn't matter. God knows. It's between you and Him. But if there's something that you need from Him, He's just waiting for you to come and just hand it over to Him. Cast your burdens upon the Lord. He'll take it from you. He wants to do that. Oh, He's got His life. He'll take it from you. As she plays, let's pray. If you've got a need, you come down to this altar and just pray. Father, we thank you so much for the opportunity to be here tonight. God, we're just praying tonight that you work in the hearts of your people. God, for those in here that may have a need, Lord, I pray that you'll touch them, Lord, with your spirit. Lord, show them that you want to take that burden from them. Lord, may we have joy and peace in you, your love. God, knowing that we're a child of yours. God, we're so thankful for sending your Son here to die on the cross and save us from our sins. Lord, we want to praise your holy name tonight. If there's one, Lord, we've got them now. We pray for you. Thank you so much. For it's in Jesus' name we pray.